Good morning. Welcome to Faith Christian Church. We want to welcome those that are worshiping with us online this morning. And for those of you that are in the room, thank you for being here. We are grateful that we get to be a part of your day and that together we can worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We're going to worship together in many different ways. We're going to worship through song. We're going to worship through hearing God's word proclaimed to us. We're going to worship through communion. If you did not receive your communion supplies when you entered the room, just raise your hand and Dave would be happy to bring the supplies to you. If you're worshiping online, take a few moments, grab some supplies so that you can participate with communion time with us. Grab some crackers or bread and some juice, and we would love to spend that time communing with our Savior together. We're also going to be worshiping through giving. If you're in the room, there's a box in the back where you can drop your offering. Or if you're online, you can visit us at our website, fccnp.org. Click the give link, and it will direct you to our online giving. If you're new to our church, we would love to connect with you. And on our website, there is a connection card. Take a few moments, fill that connection card out so that we can begin a dialogue with you about what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ and what it means to be a part of Faith Christian Church. We're excited about the things that are happening here at the church. Want to just give you a couple of quick announcements before we begin. Today, immediately following this service, we're going to be having our annual congregational meeting and lunch together. It's going to take place down at our pavilion. We want to invite you all to come out for that, share in lunch. It's all going to be provided. All you have to do is come down there. It's going to be a great lunch, pulled pork, mac and cheese, coleslaw, and some desserts. So come out for that. If you are unable to be a part of the meeting this afternoon but would like to be a part of that, send me an email, brian@fccnp.org. And we will send you a link to our meeting that's going to be recorded. We'll send you out the budget so that you can see that as well, either later on this afternoon or early next week as soon as it's all put together. We would love to have you. Next Sunday is 4th of July. 4th of July falls on Sunday, so we're going to do some things a little bit different. We're only going to have one service next week. It's at 10:30. It's going to be outside down at the pavilion, and so that service will also be live streamed. Only the 10:30 service will be live streamed because that's the only service we're going to have. But we want you to come early because beginning at 9:15 down at the pavilion, we're going to have a pancake and sausage breakfast time. I guess, did I just change the time on you, Amy? Okay. 9:15-ish. We're going to start having pancakes and sausage down at the pavilion. Come and enjoy that time. Sit, fellowship together, and just spend some time together. So we're glad to be able to do things together again in person, and we want to invite you to come out to that next Sunday. I want to invite you to stand. We're going to read some scripture today, and then we're going to begin our time of worship. Listen to what the psalmist writes in Psalm chapter 5. He says, "But I, through the abundance of your steadfast love, will enter your house. I will bow down towards your holy temple in awe of you. Lead us, O Lord, in your righteousness. Make your way straight before us. We seek your face as we worship you today."
All I see is the battle. You see my victory. All I see is the mountain. You see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. bodies with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Can be against me. For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. Cross, God, you see the empty tomb. Oh, so when I fight, I will fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh, God, battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing. Belongs to you. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I will fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And oh God, the battle belongs to you.
Okay.
such boundless grace, the God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. And hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. And hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living. Seal the promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Grip on me, you have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. And hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are my living hope.
Let's pray together. God, thank you for being our hope, our confidence, our salvation, our redemption. So, Father, we offer to you our adoration, our praise, our lives as an act of worship, holy and pleasing to you this day. God, as we turn now to the pages of Scripture, as we read today the words of Jesus, would these words cut into us today? Would they speak to us? Would your Holy Spirit move in this message and in this room and in our minds and in our hands and in our feet? Would we be changed? Would we be different because we encountered our living hope through the living Word, through Jesus today? We pray in His wonderful and precious holy name. Amen. You can be seated. Let me once again say welcome to you. Glad that you're here this morning at Faith Christian. Glad that you were tuned in and watching online. We do exist for one reason here at Faith Christian, and that is to help people find and follow Jesus. So if there's some way we can help you take your next step as a follower of Jesus, we would love to partner with you. We would love to help you take your next step as you find and follow Jesus. As Brian said earlier, you can find that connection card on the front page of our website, fccnp.org, and let us know who you are and how we can help you take your next step, how we can help you find and follow Jesus. Well, as we start today, I have to start with a bit of a confession. I'm not proud of this, but I had a moment this past week. You've had a moment before, right? I had a moment. Now, generally, I am a very gentle, easygoing kind of guy. But this past week, I had a moment. I was rude. I was maybe the word I want to use is ugly, a little ugly, short-tempered. My wife would probably use this word, obnoxious. That's probably the word she would use. But it was a moment. I had a moment. You've had a moment before, and I had a moment. Here's what had happened. We were traveling last weekend. I had a great little visit down in Tennessee with my mom and dad. Actually got to be with my dad on Father's Day for the first time, and I don't know how long, because he preaches and I preach, and so we both work on Sundays. And so for us to be together on Father's Day was a real treat. I actually got to preach for my dad at his church last week on Father's Day. It was a real nice time. Nice visit with my mom, who's recovering from a stroke. We had a nice visit. We were on our way home last Sunday afternoon. We're driving back from Tennessee back to Ohio, and we're driving through the middle of nowhere important, West Virginia. There's a bit of that. And we're driving through West Virginia, and we stopped to see some stuff, and we're having just a wonderful time, just the four of us, our family, and we're driving, and I had a moment, a little ugly, a little obnoxious, a little short-tempered, a little ill-tempered, maybe that's a better word, and then we stopped the car, and I walked into a Wendy's, and I ordered a sandwich, and we got back in the car, and I ate my sandwich. You know what happened to my mood after I ate? I was all better. All my mood, all my ugliness, all my moment was over because I ate. Here's what the experts call it, I was hangry. You ever been hangry before? It's when you're angry because you're hungry. I was hangry. It reminded me of one of the most successful advertising campaigns in recent memory. Probably you remember it from the Snickers candy bar. They said, "You're not you when you're hungry." You're not you when you're hungry. That's kind of what I want to talk about today. You're not you when you're hungry. So who are you when you're hungry? Who do you become? Are you the kind of person who just... oh, you just lose energy, and you lose interest, and you lose focus, and you can't speak, and you can't talk, you're just lethargic, you just want to mope around, you don't want to talk to anybody, just like, that's you when you're hungry, maybe that's you. Or are you the type, when you get hungry, you get belligerent, and you get short-tempered, you get hangry, you get impatient, and you get a little angry, and you get a little mean, and nobody wants to be around you because you're frustrated when you are hungry, and then you finally eat, like I did Sunday evening, and you feel better, and you're different because they're right. You're not you when you're hungry. Now, this is bigger than just food. You know this, right? This is bigger than just food. We use this word hungry a lot to describe all kinds of different things. Corporations talk about being hungry, how a business is, well, if we're going to succeed, if we're going to have a better fiscal than last year, we got to be hungry. Our sales team's got to be hungry. Our marketing team's got to be hungry. Our research and development, they're going to be hungry for the next new thing. We are hungry. That's the business hunger. We use this term to describe sports teams, about how if they're going to win the title, they got to be hungry. They got to be hungry in the gym. They got to be hungry in the weight room. They got to be hungry in the offseason. They got to be hungry in the close minutes of the last final game. If they're going to win the title, the team that's the hungriest is going to win. And what's true of corporations and what's true of sports teams is also true for you and for me as people, as individuals. We all kind of have this internal hunger. Now, there's nothing wrong with wanting to do a good job. There's nothing wrong with wanting to succeed. But some of us kind of have this tendency to get this hunger for one particular thing, that we get so hungry for this one thing, it seems like we can never be enough of whatever that one thing is. For some of us, we're hungry for attention. We just like attention. We want people to notice us. You were the class clown in school, so now you're the extrovert in every room every time. You're constantly like, hey, everybody, look at me, and you just crave attention, so you post something on Facebook about every 16 minutes, because you needed to see what bite one looked like from bite two on your sandwich. I don't know, because you need the attention, you need the validation. You want your neighbors to notice your new car. You want people at your office to notice your great ideas. You want the attention. You want people to notice you. You want the people you play golf with to go, was he on the tour? That guy's good. You want the attention. These are the kinds of things, because you're hungry for attention, and it makes you do all kinds of crazy things to get the attention of your neighbors or your relatives or your mother-in-law or whoever it is. You're hungry for attention. Some of us are hungry for money, and we just love to have more and more and more money. And so we invest and we save and we work harder and we hustle and we sell and we do whatever we can to make and get and to acquire more money, because we are hungry for money. Some of us, it's not about the money. It's about success. We just have a hunger for success. We want to succeed. We don't even care about the dollars all that much. We just like the art of the deal. We like to close the deal. We like to have gotten it done. We like to be successful at whatever occupation we're in. You want the win. And so you've got this craving, this hunger inside of you that says, I need more of that. For some of you, it's not those things. For some of us, your hunger, obviously this is my problem too, is for looking great. You just want to look good all the time. You do whatever you can to always look good. You've got this hunger to constantly be looking younger and buffer and thinner all the time. So you diet and you exercise and you nip and you tuck and you tan and you do whatever you have to do to be able to look as good as possible. That's what you hunger for. For some of us, you're hungry for credit. You want everybody to know what you did, that it was your idea. You want to be sure that you get all the credit for whatever was successful. For some of us, it's a hunger for affection, for love. You want to be valued. You want to be loved, and you hunger for that. You desire for that. And so you search for love, and you search for affection, sometimes in some really dangerous places, because you have a hunger. Whatever it is, we all have something inside of our gut that makes us hungry. The problem is, you're not you, and I'm not me when you're hungry. So let me ask you this question. What happens if you're not you when you're hungry, but you can never be satisfied? It reminds me of another Snickers commercial, right? Snickers really satisfied. That was another one of their ad campaigns. Snickers really satisfied. So what if you're hungry, and if I can quote the Stones, you can't get no satisfaction? What do you do then? What tends to happen if all your attempts to satisfy this hunger inside of you, to impress the neighbors and to impress the boss, what if it isn't enough? All of your attempts isn't enough. You see, the problem is, when we can't get satisfaction, we tend to do things that later we're going to regret. I think the best way for me to illustrate this is to talk about the lizards in Florida. I don't know if you've ever been to Florida or not. You don't have to be there long to see there's all these little lizards that just crawl around. They're on the sidewalk. They're in the trees. They're just all over the place. My kids like to catch them and play with them. There's just little bitty little gecko things, and they're running around all over the place. Well, when we lived in Florida, one of the things that we noticed is sometimes those little lizards would get into the inside. They would not just stay outside where they belong. They would come into the inside. And so in our church building in Florida, especially, we would have this problem where these lizards would get into the church building, and they would crawl around on the carpet, and they would read the junior church curriculum, and they probably took communion. I don't know what all they did in there. But they would run around for a while in the church building, and eventually the little lizard who's now inside, that's supposed to be outside, would think, I'm hungry. I need to go where I need to go to catch food and get water because I'm hungry. And so the lizard would find a tree, because that's what they naturally do. The problem with the trees that we had in our church building in Florida was that they were fake. And we had a bunch of them. And so with all the dust and collecting on the fake tree over there in the corner, you could go up one of these trees and you could shake it out, and out would fall, almost every time, out would fall a dead lizard. And it would be completely dehydrated and completely shriveled up because it had starved to death because it was hungry, but it couldn't get any satisfaction. It thought it was doing the right thing. It did some desperate measures, went to the fake tree to try to find its nourishment, but it didn't work, and the poor lizard died. I think this is kind of similar to the rest of us. Some of us will let this hunger inside of us drive us into choices that will ruin our families. It will ruin your marriage because you're constantly looking for love and affection somewhere else. You will ruin your kids because you are constantly removing boundaries, trying to win your kids' approval. You will ruin your family because you are so consumed with business and so consumed with winning at work that you don't win at home. And many times, this insatiable hunger inside of us will cause us to do things that we regret and that will ruin the things that we really love. Because the truth is, you're not you, and I'm not me when we're hungry. So I say all that today because I want to direct your attention to John chapter 6 in the New Testament. So here's the situation, John 6, this moment in the life of Jesus. Jesus has been performing miracles. He's been teaching these amazing things, and he's beginning to gain a lot of popularity with the people. And so these huge crowds are gathering every day to listen to Jesus teach and to watch Jesus perform these amazing miracles. And so these huge crowds are gathering around, and one day Jesus looks up, he's teaching, and there are at least 5,000 people gathered around listening to him teach. It's probably more like 15,000, but we'll say we're five today. So there's 5,000 people gathered around, and Jesus sees the people. It's the middle of the day, and he looks at his disciples, his closest followers, and says, "Hey, we need to give these people some lunch." And the disciples said, "Jesus, we can't do that. There's 5,000 people. We can't just go to the Giant Eagle. There's no way we can do that." Jesus says, "Find some food. We're going to feed these people." And so the disciples, some of you know this story, the disciples, they go around, they find a little sack lunch. One little boy had come to this gathering of all these people listening to Jesus and brought a little sack lunch, couple of little bitty fish, couple of pieces of bread. And Jesus prays over the food, and he begins to break the bread, and they pass it around, and all 5,000, maybe up to 15,000 people are fed their fill in that moment. The beautiful, amazing miracle of Jesus. Well, the crowd, obviously, you would too, the crowd thinks, that was really cool. Let's do that again. So all of a sudden, these 5,000 people, maybe more, they're following Jesus everywhere Jesus goes. They want to be around Jesus all the time, wouldn't you? You get a free lunch, you're seeing all this great show, all these miracles are happening, these neat things are happening, you want to be a part of the crowd. That's what they're doing. They want more thrills, they want more chills, so they're following after Jesus because they're entranced by what he's doing. Until suddenly one day Jesus stops, just right in the middle of his sermon. He just stops and says, "Okay, hold on a minute. Let's cut to the chase here. There's something more important than physical food." Listen to what Jesus says in John chapter 6, beginning of verse 26. Jesus replied, "I tell you the truth. You want to be with me because I fed you." They were there. They got the free lunch. "You want to be with me because I fed you, not because you understood the miraculous signs. But don't be so concerned about perishable things like food. Spend your energy seeking the eternal life that the Son of Man can give you. For God the Father has given me the seal of..." Jesus says, you need something more than physical food. You need something more than just a show. You need something more than just seeing the miracle. You need some kind of sustenance, something that will last. Otherwise, food's going to wear off, and you're going to be hungry again. And you guys all know that because you're going to be ready to go eat lunch in just a minute. Food's going to wear off. Jesus says, you need something more, something that has more substance. So the crowd replies in verse 28, well Jesus, we want to perform God's works too. What should we do? Jesus told them, this is the only work God wants from you. Believe in the one he sent. They answered, well, give us a little something here, Jesus. Show us a miraculous sign if you want us to believe in you. What can you do? Now, these are the same people who ate the bread and the fish a couple days before in the desert. They've seen the miracles. They've heard the teaching. What you got, Jesus? What can you do? After all, Jesus, they go on, our ancestors, they ate manna while they journeyed through the wilderness. The scripture says Moses gave them bread from heaven to eat. Jesus said, I tell you the truth. That's Jesus' way of saying, listen, that's what that means. I tell you the truth. Listen, Moses didn't give you bread from heaven. My Father did. And now he offers you the true bread from heaven. The true bread of God is the one who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Sir, they said, give us that bread every day. Jesus replied, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry again. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. I tell you the truth, anyone who believes has eternal life. Yes, I am the bread of life. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Anyone who eats this bread will live forever, and this bread, which I will offer so the world may live, is my flesh. What Jesus is saying here is, you're not you when you're hungry. And you're always going to be hungry, Jesus says, until you have me. Now that's some pretty heavy stuff there. So what do we do with all this? What does all this mean? Well, let's fast forward a couple of years in the life of Jesus to the day before Jesus is crucified. And Jesus gathers in an upper room with his disciples, his closest friends, and they are going to have what you and I now refer to as the Last Supper. It was the Passover meal. All Jewish people would have been sharing a similar meal that night all over Jerusalem. I brought a picture. You've seen this picture before. There's the picture. You've seen this picture before. It's that moment when Jesus said, hey guys, let's all get on this one side of the table and take a selfie. That's just making sure you're paying attention. All right, that's how Da Vinci did it. All right, so that's the picture. All right, that's the moment. And we know this moment. We celebrate this moment every week in this room. That's the moment. They get together, Jesus and all these disciples get together to have a meal, a very traditional, a very religious, a very symbolic, religious, important meal. This meal was called the Passover meal. And the Jewish people, the Hebrew people, had been eating this meal, the same meal, one time a year, for 1,400 years. That's longer than there's been in America. That's how long, when Jesus and the disciples said, the Jewish people have been doing this for 1,400 years at that point, to remember the day that God, when they were slaves in Egypt, that God passed over them and brought death to their captors, but not to them. And this meal, this Passover meal, it's a very complicated meal. It's filled with so many different elements and pieces and parts, and every piece and every part has a story, has a symbolism, has a meaning, and you would talk about every single piece of the meal and every plate. Everything meant something in the meal. We don't have time to talk about all today, but there's herbs and there's greens and there's lamb and there's bread. In fact, there was a little basket with bread in it, with a white cloth over the top of it. And that's where the bread would go, in this basket with the white cloth on top of it. And it would be covered up, and this was referred to as the hidden bread, because it had the towel over it, had a cloth over it. And the hidden bread would sit not at the table where everyone was eating, like, you know, if you go to Thanksgiving and grandma's going to put the roll basket on the table. Now, not on the table with everybody. The hidden bread sat on a separate table way off to the side in the room. And that's where the hidden bread went, over away from everything, and it was symbolic. Remember, everything had a symbol. Everything had a meaning. And the hidden bread was symbolic about the hidden one, the one who would one day come and save his people from their sins. He would save the world, and that would be the very Son of God, the Messiah, and that's what the hidden bread represents in the Passover meal. So for 1,400 years, these Jewish people had been getting together once a year to have this amazing, important religious meal to remember, to commemorate what God did, and they would set aside the hidden bread to say, one day the hidden one is going to come, and he is going to bring us satisfaction. Well, Jesus sits down to have this meal with his disciples. And that bread is sitting over there. And so they go through all the pieces and parts of the meal. I want you to notice what happens during the meal. This is from Matthew 26. as they were eating, Jesus took some bread and blessed it. Then he broke it in pieces and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take this and eat it, for this is my body." Now, here's what's absolutely amazing about this. Jesus didn't just grab some random breadstick off the table. Jesus got up, went over, got the basket of the hidden bread, brought it back to the table, and said, "This is my body." And in that moment, those disciples who were sitting around the table, who have been doing Passover since they were babies, since they were old enough to remember, they would have begun to figure it out. What Jesus is saying, the hidden one is no longer hidden. He's here, Jesus says, and it's me. But Jesus doesn't stop there. It goes on in verse 27. And he took a cup of wine, and he gave thanks to God for it. He gave it to them and said, "Each of you drink from it, for this is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people. It is poured out as a sacrifice to forgive the sins of many." Jesus begins to allude to how his body is going to be broken, and how his blood is going to be spilt out on the cross in just a few short hours from this moment, from the upper room. And Jesus begins to talk about how he is going to be the final sacrifice for all of our sin. Up until then, they've been killing animals to try to appease God for their sins. Now Jesus would be the final sacrifice. And as Jesus begins passing out this bread and say, "I want you to eat this bread to remember my body, which is about to be broken on a cross." And ever since that day, the church has been gathering together to celebrate something called communion, or the Eucharist, where we break bread, where we drink from a cup, and we celebrate and commemorate and remember what Jesus did. Jesus wants us to know that what's about to happen, it's going to be violent, it's going to be gruesome, body broken, blood spilled, it's going to be gruesome, but it was done for us. Jesus says, "You're not you when you're hungry, but the good news is, satisfaction has come," and Jesus says, "It's me." Maybe that's what you needed to hear today. The truth of the matter is, all of us are looking for something, someone, some experience to satisfy that hunger that is inside of us, but nothing will work. Some of you have let that hunger lead you into some really horrible decisions in your life. And some of you have you've limped in here this morning because of those decisions, because of that wreckage of your life. You've limped in here. Listen to me. If that's you, there is hope. You can find satisfaction. Some of you have let this hunger bring you right to the brink, and you are like this close to making a really bad decision. You're making plans. You're scheming. If that's you, listen to me. There is hope. You can find real satisfaction. Some of us, we've just given up. We've decided, "I'm just going to always be empty." But listen to me. You don't have to live that way. There is hope. You can find satisfaction, because you're not you when you're hungry. But Jesus came so that you could be filled. That's why this whole Jesus thing matters. Because you don't have to be hungry anymore. Megan, my wife, and I dated. It was about a year and a half before I got up the courage to propose to her. About a year and a half. Actually, it took about that long for her to warm up to the idea of spending the rest of her life with me. But that's what it takes. I think maybe I've told you about the night I proposed to Megan for, because it was a pretty good night. It was beautiful. It was December, and I was already living in Florida. She was still in school in Nashville, and she was on Christmas break, so she'd flown down to Florida for a couple of days, and we just had a beautiful, we'd gone up to the city of St. Augustine, which is a beautiful historic city. And it's Christmas time, it's, you know, it's mid-December, late December. There's white lights on all the buildings in downtown St. Augustine, just beautiful, and the bridge is all lit up. It's nighttime, and we're just walking along the river. It's just a beautiful setting, beautiful evening. We got under this, like, gazebo pavilion thing, and it's all lit up with these beautiful white Christmas lights. And I looked at her, and I said, and I quote, "So, you want to get married?" Yeah, that's what I said. That's exactly how I said it. And she'll agree. That's exactly how I said it. So, you want to get married? And I pulled a ring from out of my pocket, and I showed it to her. And, of course, she said, "You are going to get down on one knee, right?" And I said, "Yes, of course, I'm going to get down on one knee." And got down on one knee, and there's people watching. And it was just a beautiful, I pulled it off. It was a beautiful moment. It was really sweet. It was just a gorgeous, gorgeous moment. As great as it was, as great as that moment was, as much fun as that is, as much as we still remember telling the story, despite how beautiful everything was around us, with all the lights in the night and all the thing, despite how the ring that I pulled out of my pocket, despite how much money I spent on the ring that had been in my pocket, despite the gesture, despite pulling it all off, none of it meant anything until she said yes. Same thing is true of Jesus. It doesn't matter if you believe Jesus existed. It doesn't matter if you acknowledge that Jesus lived. It doesn't matter if you sit here every Sunday and nod along with all the things I say from this platform. It doesn't matter all the grand gestures that Jesus has gone through until you say yes. So here's my question for you today. I leave you with this. Are you ready to say yes to the only one who can satisfy you? Because you're not you, and I'm not me when we're hungry. Let me pray for you. God, thank you for being the one who satisfies. The living bread of life, the living water, the one who came so that we could live, we could be satisfied, we could have life to the abundant, to the fullest. God, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for that redeeming final work on the cross, for that body and blood spilt for us. And God, as we move now to our time of communion, as we share together in the body of Christ by eating this bread and drinking from this cup, as we remember and celebrate and commemorate the death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus, Father, would you remind us in this moment, as we eat and we drink, would you remind us that Jesus is the bread of life? And while we may not be us when we're hungry, that this body, this blood, this bread, this cup reminds us every week that we can find satisfaction. We find it only in you. That's our prayer today in the name of Jesus. Amen. If you have your communion bag with you, if you want to go ahead and open that up, pull out your cup, your bread, get those open up so we can partake together. If you're watching with us at home, we hope that you have something at your house that you can use to represent the body and blood of Jesus so that you can participate with us now in the body of Christ. We do this every week here at Faith Christian. We participate in the body and the blood of Jesus by sharing communion, by the Lord's Supper, the Eucharist. If this is new to you, you can take a pass on it, but we want you to know that you are invited. You are welcome to share together with us in the body and the blood of Christ. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and broke it. He passed it to his disciples and said, "Take this and eat it, for this is my body." And he took a cup of wine, and he gave thanks to God for it. He gave it to them and said, "Each of you drink from it, for this is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people. It is poured out as a sacrifice to forgive the sins of many." The body and the blood of Christ for the people of Christ.
Would you all stand with us?
You came for criminals and every Pharisee. You came for hypocrites, even one like me. You carried sin and shame, the guilt of every man, the weight of all I've done, nailed into your hands. And oh, your love bled for me. Oh, your blood in crimson streams. And oh, your death is hell's defeat. A cross meant to kill is my victory. Grace, I've seen and tasted it. It's running through my veins. I can't escape its grip. In you, my soul is safe. You cover everything. And oh, your love bled for me. And oh, your death is hell's defeat. A cross meant to kill is my victory.
Takes away our sin. The Holy Lamb of God makes us alive again, makes us alive again. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away our sin, who takes away our sin. Oh, your love bled for me. Oh, your blood in crimson streams. And oh, your death is hell's defeat. A cross meant to kill is my victory. Meant to kill is my victory.
Hey, thanks for being here, everyone. Don't forget, we have lunch down at the pavilion right now. And next week, we have one service at 10:30 down at the pavilion and breakfast beforehand at 9:15. Sweet. So, love you all. We'll see you again next week. We'll be right back.